I'm Kweli Washington, and this is Counterculture. My guest this evening is an award-winning documentary filmmaker with an uncanny knack for channeling the zeitgeist. Her debut feature-length film was Startup.com, the definitive account of the internet boom and bust of the early 2000s. Her follow-up was Control Room, a tense account of the wary symbiosis of the U.S. military and Al Jazeera during the Iraq War. Recently, she completed The Square, a ground-up depiction of the revolution in Egypt in 2011 and the complex and challenging times that have ensued in that country since. The film has won awards at Sundance and Toronto and will be released in theaters and on Netflix starting on January the 17th. It is a special honor for us to welcome Jehane Noujaim to the Counterculture set. Without further ado, let's turn the counter to cinema.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.
Thank you, Jehane, so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So you have demonstrated in all the films that you've made a real ability to sort of capture the zeitgeist of the particular moment in time, whether it's Startup.com with the internet boom and bust, or Control Room with the Iraq War, and now The Square with what's happening and happened in the Arab Spring in Egypt and continues. When did you know that you wanted to be a filmmaker, and how did you have the sort of ability to anticipate the potential path when you were in college?
I went to college to be a doctor.
Okay.
Yeah, to do pre-med. So I did that and then took, I think, Chem 5 or something and realized that there were many other people that were going to be much better in this field.
Was that an organic chemistry class or something along
something
those
like
lines?
That.
Right,
yeah,
sure,
definitely.
One of these sort of weeder.
Yeah.
Type deals.
Not for the weak-hearted.
Sure.
So I took refuge in the photography and film labs. Mm-hmm.
And had you done film and photography beforehand at all?
No.
Wow.
I fell in love with it. Totally fell in love with it. And that's what I wanted to do. And then basically pretty soon after college met Chris and Penny Baker and made my first film with them, Startup.com.
And realized, how'd you meet them?
I met them... Well, first of all, you know Khalil.
Who, the film. Featured in the film,
yes.
Prominently.
So I had started filming what they were doing, what they were up to. You know, Khalil's getting these checks for hundreds of thousands of dollars and for the, you know, first round of financing. And I was like, I've got to understand how this all works.
Sure.
Started filming him, thought maybe it could be a good business school case study.
Mm-hmm.
And then met Chris and Penny Baker, who were starting to make a film about the same subject. So we decided to join forces.
Got it. And their idea was to make a film kind of thematically the same, but you really had the sort of scoop, as it were, on Khalil and GovWorks and
They were actually looking at the VC side, like venture capital side. So, and then they thought the sort of Khalil and Tom side was more interesting.
Sure.
And so I think
merge forces.
Yeah. So that was amazing, and I felt like if I can. You know, people were so fascinated by Khalil and Tom and what they're doing now, and I thought if an audience like that can get so involved in characters after watching a film for, you know, an hour and a half, how amazing would it be to actually start doing stuff on the Middle East and try to bring characters to life there? And then that's when I made Control Room.
Well, I tell you what, the medical profession suffers for not having you in it, but the rest of us have certainly benefited from you bringing your kind of amazing eye and commitment to the craft to the rest of us. What is it that you seek to accomplish in making the films that you do? What are you trying to achieve in that regard?
I think it's really simple. First of all, you pick a subject that you're excited about learning about, and then when you find that you're experiencing a world that normally people don't get to experience, but that's moving you in a big way, you want to be able to share it with the world. Mm-hmm. So you figure out a way, a story to tell, to be able to share a glimpse of that experience, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's why
that's
it's
the
about.
Deal. And when you kind of think about the various elements of filmmaking, whether it be the, you know, kind of actual, you know, meeting folks out in the field, kind of rolling the camera, managing the crew of people involved, taking a step back, then once you've got the footage and being in the editing room, what are the sort of favorite aspects of the craft itself that you enjoy?
I know, I enjoy all the creative stuff I love. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, think about basically deciding that you want to find out or be in the middle of something and experience it through fascinating characters too. Mm-hmm. Like, you look for people that are going to surprise you, challenge you, take you on an amazing journey,
sure.
You know? And then you get to follow them. Mm-hmm. So it's like, that's an incredible part of it. Mm-hmm. And you're running after the story as quickly as you can. And then the next phase of editing is really where the brain work comes in, taking mm-hmm. something like 1,600 hours and making it into
sure.
a 90-minute film.
That's a daunting task.
It's nuts,
yeah,
you know?
Uh-huh.
And
all of it pretty amazing footage.
Yeah. Uh-huh. No, I mean, really good stuff. We could have made 100 films from this body of footage. Mm-hmm. So. But I both sides of it I love.
Mm-hmm. And with the square, I'm sort of struck by the graphic kind of being there nature of it, on the one hand. Also, just how personal the political is, right? And you're tracking these individuals who were camped out in the square, and it turns out they, you know, have different kind of political affiliations and perhaps different conceptions of what the revolution becomes. But are all sort of there, galvanized in the event of bringing it about. How did you get to Tahrir Square? How did you find the people whom you followed? How did you shoot under conditions that must have been challenging, to say the least?
How did I get there? Well, I grew up 10 minutes away from Tahrir. So,
okay.
I mean, I know
it's your backyard.
Well. It's my backyard, exactly. But if you'd ever told me that a few years ago that I would be spending so much time on that piece of land,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't have ever thought that would happen. But what was happening was that Tunisia had exploded.
Mm-hmm.
There had been this huge, there'd been this police brutality towards a guy in Alexandria called mm-hmm. Khalid Said, and mm-hmm. a Facebook page created, and, you know, thousands of people signed up for this Facebook page. And went down to the streets in protest, and it was bubbling. Mm-hmm. And I'd made a film in 2007 called Egypt, We're Watching You, about three women who are fighting for political change in Egypt. And I was constantly talking with them, and they were saying, no, this is going to be it.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
I mean, this wasn't
know.
Just a kind of momentary agitation. Yeah. There was something substantial here that
and
was going to
take
hold.
Protest that was going to, and the, you know, the big difference between what happened on the 25th was not necessarily what happened on the 25th, but on the 26th. So unlike other previous protests where people went and got beaten up and went home mm-hmm. and didn't come back, everybody came back on the 26th, mm-hmm. and 27th, and 28th, and then stayed.
Mm-hmm.
And stayed in the square. And, you know, it's again, a sign of the times. I mean, look, it's happening in squares around the world,
sure,
right?
Sure.
And so, to me, I was very curious about how can you use a piece of land, a piece of public land, to actually make demands. And so it was a no-brainer that I wanted to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I think, the entire crew, and we all met in the square, all were there as sort of Egyptians or protesters, and then secondly as kind of filmmakers
Got it.
Or camera
So the
people.
Crew of folks who worked with you behind the scenes to bring it all together were people who you also met in the school.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't realize
yeah,
that at
yeah,
all.
Yeah. The whole crew came together, and it was the most collaborative, incredible, magical mm-hmm. way a project could come together. I mean, I met the DP in the square, who was like, you have no idea how you're using this camera completely wrong. Because when I landed, I got all of my gear taken
by the authorities
uh-huh. right? And I had brought in a 5D because they pass as basically photography cameras.
Sure.
So I came in with the 5D. Our DP taught us how to use the 5Ds, met our producer in the square. It was an amazing
wow.
collaboration.
Uh-huh. And you also then met the principals who you feature in the story.
Right.
And how did you meet some of those guys?
So Ahmed, who's the main character, mm-hmm. the lead, is this, you see him grow up in the film, but when you meet him, he was this charismatic kid that would start speaking. He'd be surrounded by 50 people after 5 minutes of him sort of bringing people together for conversation. He would have 50 people surrounding him. He had this sort of pure, joyous spirit and so principled. I think that's the, you know, what all of the characters in the film share is this very principled nature, mm-hmm. where, you know, there's no compromise on your principles,
sure,
especially
sure.
when it's this kind of founding period where a constitution is being written, where everything is being reshaped.
Mm-hmm.
So Ahmed, you just wanted to make this journey with him,
sure.
you know, through his eyes.
Yep.
Khaled was this guy who, he was a star in The Kite Runner,
mm-hmm.
in Green Zone. He's an actor who is quite a successful actor, could be any place else in the world, but mm-hmm. chose to be there. Comes from a
Egyptian
long line.
Egyptian by birth,
yeah.
and...
And comes from a mm-hmm. long line of political activism.
Okay.
His father was jailed, grandfather mm. was jailed. So he, you know, he had this in his blood, and
sure.
he really understood it. He was able to be very articulate about where things were at in very confusing times.
Mm.
So it's a good sort
good
of
voice
person
to have. As
to
part
have.
Of it. Sure,
yeah.
sure.
And then Magdi was a Muslim Brotherhood character, who, a guy who we met who was sleeping in the tent next to ours,
mm-hmm.
and was very open and to, you know, people who were secular, was curious about how they saw the future of
sure.
Egypt. So it was this incredible time seeing people of all classes, different religious backgrounds, men and women, you know, thinking about and feeling like we had a hand in our future for
sure,
the first time.
Sure. And it strikes me that, you know, with life here where the kind of revolutionary moments are few and far between, muted, you know, 200 plus years ago, if we really kind of go back to it, you know, it's always appealing to me to think of the kind of, you know, the sort of a romance almost,
right.
to the sort of founding moment, the sort of moment where anything is possible. Did you have that sense in the square, that sort of democracy was in action, that the sort of people were on the move, and that there was a genuine potential for transformative change associated with people power?
For sure, for sure. I felt like, you know, and I came with a bit of a cynical attitude because I'd marched against the Iraq War
mm-hmm.
in New York.
Sure.
And
cold weather,
happened,
probably.
You know?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so I went there thinking, I don't know how this is going to end. But then when you see something that you imagine is absolutely impossible,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I grew up in Cairo where, you know, you couldn't get into political discussions easily with people because people would be very nervous
mm, so
about
just a
that.
Guarded sense,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
you don't want to
yeah.
say
you
too much.
You don't know
much.
Who you're
yeah,
talking
sure.
to. So that fear was broken.
Mm.
And so to feel that possibility for change in a country and a spirit that was really changing and this different consciousness happening
mm-hmm.
was, it definitely, it felt amazing. It felt like people power can actually make changes.
Make something happen,
yeah.
sure. Let me ask you a question about the Muslim Brotherhood and about kind of what's transpired, you know, towards, yeah, kind of as the years now have passed since 2011. Do you feel as though the Muslim Brotherhood betrayed the revolution?
I don't, you see the character of Magdi in the
mm-hmm.
film, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
do I feel like foot soldiers of the Muslim Brotherhood betrayed the revolution? No.
Mm-hmm.
But I do feel like the leadership of the Muslim mm-hmm. Brotherhood betrayed
mm-hmm.
the revolution and therefore also betrayed their followers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So a kind of sense that the elites of whatever stripe, military, kind of previous regime, Muslim Brotherhood.
No, I think that's right.
This gets referred to in the film, even the sort of this sort of sense that
and there was
some
a certain point
happening.
There was a certain point when the youth of the Brotherhood actually really fought with the senior leadership
mm.
and said, you know, what we're facing as an organization is exactly the same thing that the youth are fighting all over Egypt,
mm-hmm.
which is this sort of very top-down kind of authoritarian approach.
Sure, sure. And do you believe that the military expressed the will of the people when they ousted Morsi?
Oh, I think that, so what the protests were about and what the petition that was signed was calling for early elections.
Mm.
So what everybody went down to the street to say when, if you saw the film,
mm.
you know, millions of people came down. Imagine a third of the U.S. coming down into the streets.
A single place, yeah.
So what happened at that point where people were saying, you know, you will not use the tools of democracy to create another dictatorship.
Mm-hmm.
You will not use religion to manipulate. And that's something that will go down in history is, you know, all of these people in the most populous country in the Arab world, religious people came down and said, do not use Islam in this way. Mm-hmm. When the army came in to remove Morsi, did he need to be removed with a gun to his head? Did he need to be put in? You know, the process with which it happened did not follow the demands of all of the people that went down. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But, however, I do think that the only way for Morsi to step aside, as demonstrated in his speech, was for the army to come in. Mm-hmm. What mm-hmm. happened in Rabaa after that, meaning the massacre that happened after that, mm-hmm. I think was obviously, you know, completely wrong, uncalled for, and a horrible, inhumane mm-hmm. action.
Mm-hmm. What is the perception of the military in the eyes of the people now? There was this sort of notion of, was it kind of the military and the people are one, or hand in glove, or some, you know?
No, I think we're going through a very pro-military time right now. I mean, mm-hmm. among the general population. I haven't been back since before the massacre happened, and, you know, mm-hmm. I left right before that happened, and I haven't been back. But sort of reports, my family's there, it is a very pro-military time, which mm-hmm. leads to the question of, do we take the film there now and show it, or do we wait until, you know, January?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Are there sort of, you know, risks of censorship in terms of having the film portrayed there?
What film
do you
is
contend
in
with in that regard?
The film is in censorship right now. Mm-hmm. They say they're waiting on permission from the military.
Okay.
If you saw the film, you saw that the first half of the film is, you know, very critical mm-hmm. of some of the actions mm-hmm. that were taken by the military. So, you know, we'll see.
It'll be a real test of democracy.
It will be.
Of the freedom of expression, I suppose.
And I don't
know.
Otherwise, we'll just have to figure out some other creative way to get it out there.
Sure, sure. And what do you see as the future of Egypt?
I mean, you know, I'm not an expert. I'm a filmmaker.
But you're someone who's sort of
reminding you of that. But
I can tell you what I feel.
I can tell you what I feel. Mm-hmm. I feel like this whole revolution has gone in waves, and things have had to get really bad before they get better mm-hmm. again. But the thing that leaves me deeply optimistic is that people continue to rise up, and people continue to hold their leaders accountable, mm-hmm. whether that's, you know, and fight against fascism, whether the face of that fascism is Mubarak or the military or the Muslim Brotherhood. Mm-hmm. And so I do believe this revolution was all about creating an alternative and not falling into those binaries of Muslim Brotherhood or military. Mm-hmm. The idea is that it's these sort of, you know, organized fascist movements versus these disorganized social movements.
Sure.
And the hope is that these disorganized social movements will gain a strength, and with time, they
coordinate
are developing
action a little
themselves.
Bit more
exactly.
without becoming fascists
right.
themselves.
And I'm deeply optimistic about sure. some of the people that I've met who are very prominent in these movements.
Sure. Well, I'd just say, you know, each of the principles in his own way in the film is deeply compelling and inspiring. Let me take you back to sleeping in a tent in the square. What was the kind of, you know, what were the smells, what were the tastes, what were the sort of day-to-day rhythms of that experience? And had you ever had anything like that to compare it to?
You know, it was, the square has had its own personality and its own character in mm-hmm. the film. But initially, being there, it was a magical place. People were helping each other. You know, there was, you know, there was this. It was its own little city that was created.
Sure.
You know, yeah. Other than that, you got to go see the movie.
Got to go see the film. Well, I've had the joy of watching it on a small screen. I'm looking forward to seeing it on a big screen at some point soon.
Good.
I had Albert Maysles in this mm-hmm. chair, and I asked him if he ever felt in danger, in peril, at any time during shooting of films that he's worked on. I was thinking in particular of Give Me Shelter, with the death at the Rolling Stones concert. But let me ask you that question. Did you ever feel in peril while shooting this film? Have you,
you know, in other circumstances felt in danger as you were doing the work of being a filmmaker? And kind of how does that inform your experience?
The last time that it felt, I'd say a little, you know, it was difficult, was that when we were shooting Egypt, We're Watching You, about these three women in 2007. But it was sort of much, it was more, they would get phone calls every time we would leave, and the secret police would be saying, oh, I see that the camera people are still there, the film is still being made, you know? Which was, it's just a strange thing to feel that somebody's watching you. This process of shooting The Square was much more in your face. Like you know you're in a dangerous situation, right? And the key thing is that I don't think myself or any of the crew would have been there if they didn't feel like they would have been there anyway, not as filmmakers. You know, I mean, nobody did I bring into this situation, and it's amazing. I mean, if you grew up in Berkeley. If Berkeley exploded in front of you, you know, I think you would be there.
Sure.
It's like, it's that idea of danger sort of disappears, and it's because it's something that's much more important that you're fighting for, that's much bigger than yourself, that becomes more important.
So you get caught up in it because it's a part of you in a way.
You do.
Yeah.
You do.
You know, in Berkeley, the only thing I can liken it to, which is a really terrible, poor example, was after the Rodney King verdict in the early 90s, there was a lot of unrest in Los Angeles, obviously, somewhat, a small amount in the Bay Area. But I think the takeaway was that people ended up looting University of California Berkeley jackets out of the local thing, and that was about as revolutionary as they got. So a far cry from Tahrir Square. But if something were really going down, yes, I guess I would want to be there and be a part of it. Let's talk a bit about the vision for how the film gets rolled out to the public as we move forward. You recently inked a deal with Netflix to distribute it through Netflix. That's going to happen on January the 17th. It's going to have a theatrical release in conjunction with that in 8 cities.
That's right.
I'd say it's a pretty different distribution model from the startup.com time of 2001 to The Square here in 2013. How do you see this all playing out, the sort of distribution through Netflix, kind of what documentary film, how people get access to media as we move forward?
Well, we decided to do this in a very different kind of way, but there's nothing about the making of this film that's been done in the normal way.
Sure, so it's all been revolutionary.
Right. So we're trying something different, which is basically that we feel like this will get out to the widest and most diverse audience.
Sure.
Here in the States, and it's also being distributed across Latin America.
And through Netflix,
yeah,
there as well.
America, UK, and the
That's
US
great.
And Canada.
And all released at the same time.
All
accessible
released
on
at
January
the same
70th.
Time.
That's
there you
pretty
go.
Darn exciting.
And then eight cities theatrically. So no, we're excited about it. It's a very different way than I released either startup.com or Control Room, which started in the theaters and did a platform release and then went, you know, one after the other, that onto television, and then, you know, I don't even know if we have an SVOD section in the contract in my last two films. I don't think anyone cared about whatever.
Sure.
So
now
yes,
it's front and center.
Things have changed.
Well, it's really exciting. Congratulations
Thank
on
you.
That on
Thank
the release.
You.
I mean, the pending release. I think it's gonna be brilliant. And let me just close out with a kind of sense of your vision for the world. I mean, I read that when you won your TED Prize, you brought the resources that you got access to together to create Pangea Day, a day for people in a variety of different geographies to come together, I think online, right, with access to sort of video conferencing to engage their love in learning a film, right? In a way, it's that was 2007. 2008?
It was 2008.
Got it.
And don't ask me how a disorganized person like myself wishes to do the most organizationally massive effort on the face of the earth.
I mean, but it strikes me that you clearly have some some real systems capabilities, because even going out to the square and ultimately recruiting your, you know, your cast or your principal characters and your crew from the square is a pretty significant organizational effort. But anyway, I was thinking about Pangea Day and this sort of coordinated piece. And I guess it just sort of gave me some pause for thought. You know, what do you see as the end game with respect to documentary film as an art form, as a social and political commentary form? Is it a medium for bringing people together? How do you see technology kind of playing a role there? Because the technology is a whole lot different than it was in Pangea Day as well, right? You can sort of pull that
right.
off more easily.
That's a lot
now.
Of questions.
Uh-huh.
So
it's a grand finale. It's like the fireworks at the end.
So you know, we didn't even have Skype when we were doing Pangea Day.
Right.
We weren't Skyping with our filmmakers or anything. And so it would be a lot easier to put
it
together right now.
But
it was an incredible process. And it also went on the idea that you can get a lot across in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Because our call out to people was, if you had a few minutes of the world's attention, what story would you tell?
Sure.
And that's what we put together. And in the end, it was 1,800 locations in 100 countries of the world. And it was a...
That's pretty revolutionary.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. And TEDx came out of it, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Like a lot of the people that worked on Pangea ended up going and doing TEDx.
Well, you heard it here
so
first, folks. TEDx. Jehane invented TEDx.
No, Chris Anderson said it, actually. No, I didn't say
That's fantastic. I didn't realize that. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
So you see more people coming together to collaborate with tools that enable the distances to be bridged. I mean, is that kind of where we're moving?
There you go. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's exactly right. And the thing is that why have we wanted to continue, you know, we're distributing it on Netflix to get it out widely, but we still strongly feel like these films are films. And this is what Pangea was about as well, was having people watch in group and be able to have discussions afterwards. And
a collective experience is still, you don't want to have people sitting in their homes in sort of closed spaces. You want them to discuss and
so that's why we're so excited also about the way that this is being distributed, because we're able to get it out on Netflix. We're going to be doing a college tour simultaneously, and we're also going to be releasing in theaters. So,
Jehane, thank you so much for taking the time out this evening. It's been wonderful to have you here.
Thank you.
Congratulations on the film. Is there a website that folks can go to get information about release dates, the release date and locations, et cetera?
We're at thesquarefilm.com.
Okay.
And our Facebook page is the same thing.
Got it.
So.
Spelt as it sounds.
Yes.
Okay, good. And where are we going to find you in the next few weeks and months here in the world?
We're going to be, you know, someplace around, starting worldwide revolutions.
Fomenting the worldwide revolution, folks. You heard it here first. With that, let's bring to a close this edition of Counterculture. I'm Kweli Washington. She's Jehane Noujaim. And let's cue the music.
I often think of the life I've led. And oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise. My mother told me, and father told me too, said, my child, it'll all catch up with you. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.